Thank you, Tom. Thank you, everybody, for coming out this evening. And I really appreciate you guys showing up so that I can talk about some of the research that I've been doing for the last 10 years on how the Mexican far north became the American Southwest. And where it came out of was, as Tom was describing, dissertation research I was doing as I was a graduate student at the University of Virginia, and then for the last 7 years as a faculty member at the University of North Texas. It's all culminated in this book that I just published called Seeds of Empire. And the idea of the book has been basically to try to understand how it was that the area we live in today, Texas, this huge territory, went through such an incredible transformation during the first half of the 19th century. When you think about it, from 1800 to 1850, Texas went from being this territory that was controlled by the Comanches, claimed by Spain, but truly controlled by the Comanches, to becoming a thriving state within Mexico, to becoming an independent republic. Here we go. There's the book. But it's just my way of getting into. So here we're talking about right here, okay? So this whole territory right here, the area in which we live right now, had gone from being controlled by the Comanches to being a thriving Mexican state, to being an independent republic for 9 whole years, to being the westernmost outpost of the United States, right? And that all happens in 50 years, which is incredible. For anyone who's older than high school age, right, you understand, like, 50 years is a really short time frame. But it was incredibly consequential, because that transformation from Comanche hinterland to American state in 50 years is what leads ultimately to the U.S.-Mexico War that redefines the border between the United States and Mexico into what it is today, something that we're still fighting about, that we're still arguing about, that we still feel the repercussions of up until the present day. So those 50 years really matter if you want to understand North America. And the epicenter of all that, I would argue, is this territory that seems to be at the center of all those changes. And I want to understand, how did that happen? I wrote this book entirely trying to figure out why that was, because I could find books on the Texas Revolution. I could find books on the Republic. I could find books on Northern Mexico. But I couldn't find anything that tried to understand this broader situation. How did things change so dramatically over that time period, remaking this whole region right here? And what I came to in doing all of that work and all of that research and all of that writing was, in some ways, almost an answer that seemed too simple at first. It was cotton. All right. Everything seemed to be coming back to cotton because it was the most valuable and important commodity of the 19th century. Everything oil has been since World War II, all right, cotton was in the 19th century. It was the most profitable and most powerful economic staple of the entire Atlantic world. And cotton seemed to be at the center of all of these transformations. And because of that, so too was slavery. Because in the 19th century, before the Civil War, slavery was the labor system at the very heart of the explosion of cotton cultivation in North America during that time period. And those two pieces seem to be at the very center of so much of those changes and transformations. So that's what I want to talk to you guys about. I wanted to give you guys a kind of overview of how that process happened and how all those things remade where we live from a Comanche hinterland into the westernmost outpost of the United States by 1845. And the story there begins not in Texas, not even in North America, but in Great Britain, all right? Because what I always explain to my students when I teach the Texas History Survey at UNT every semester is that everything the United States has been since World War II, the most dominant economic, political, and military power in the world, the British were all of those things in the 19th century. The British Empire was all of those things in every way, shape, or form. And a large measure of the British power at that time was their naval influence and their trade empire that they had created and built. And so much of that trade empire was built on textiles. The British textile industry was massive, it was a huge part of their export economy, and it had run for a very long time heavily on wool. Until the late 1700s, when people discovered that cotton turns out to be really comfortable to wear. I'm sure a lot of you guys are wearing cotton right now. And that had been something that a lot of industrialists in Manchester and England had been experimenting with, but it took a few inventions of cotton gins, which is short for engine, for taking the seeds out of cotton fibers, to be able to make that a profitable thing. And that happened during the late 1700s, the early 1800s. And when that started happening, British industrialists started experimenting with printing cotton cloth. And it turned out you could sell tons of this stuff. because you could print all kinds of cool designs on these things. They were more comfortable, they were more durable. The market was just rabid for cotton. And so the British were starting to buy as much cotton as they could possibly buy. And then there was this pesky thing called the War of 1812 that happened, and that went on for a few years. And at the end of the War of 1812 and 1815, the British go back to buying cotton. And they go back to buying cotton on a big scale, and they transition most of their textile industry towards cotton, which means they are now paying top dollar to anyone who can grow raw cotton and ship it over to England. And that starts one of the largest and most powerful migrations in all of American history. We almost never talk about it this way. But starting in 1815, when the price of cotton doubled from 15 to 30 cents a pound, all right, there was a rush of hundreds of thousands of people down into the Mississippi River Valley, all right, up and down the Mississippi River, and the territories became Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana. All these arrows you see are people moving along rivers and riverways, or coming around and going up the rivers. The rivers of the night were the highways of the 19th century. And they're coming into these territories because the Gulf Coast turns out, in the 19th century, to be one of the absolute best places you could possibly grow cotton. It had a long, hot growing season, so you could grow for a very long time. You could get more crop done that way. You had rich alluvial soils, and best of all, you had a great coastline right here, where you could load up ships from Liverpool, England, and send it off to the English. You could bring it up and down the Mississippi River, because 450-pound cotton bales are hard to move by cart. It seemed absolutely perfect, and so people rushed in by the thousands and the tens of thousands and the hundreds of thousands to come into this territory to start building what we now know as the Deep South. Mississippi, Alabama, they become states in 1817 and 1819 respectively because people pour in by the tens of thousands to build these plantations and small family farms, these factories in the field where you're growing cotton as much as you possibly can, cleaning it, baling it, putting it on this steamship, and sending it out. Because if you could do that, if you could load up a ship with cotton, you could literally make a boatload of money. The British would pay everything they could to get it because they could make way more selling it processed in the rest of Europe and across the Atlantic. And it was this incredible movement that transformed Mississippi and Alabama from nothing into something in 5 years. It's an incredible transformation. Part of that movement, though, of course, involved the labor source that was running so many of these plantations, right? Which was slavery. And so 40%, which is an incredibly large percentage of the people who are coming, 40% of the people who are coming are not coming voluntarily. There are men, women, and children who are being brought to these plantations, brought to these farms, brought to this region to grow the cotton, to work the fields, to clean them, to run the gins, and do all the work that it takes to grow cotton. And because white Anglo-Americans of the age truly believed, they were wrong, but they truly did believe that you needed slave labor to make a plantation truly profitable. You could grow cotton with just your own hands, with your own family, on your small family farm, and most Southerners did do that. But everybody dreamed of being able to own a slave if you could, because then you could grow so much more cotton, and you could make so much more money, and that could actually make you wealthy. And so many who could afford to did, and the cotton profits during this time made it possible for far more people to own slaves than ever could before. The prices of slaves start going up as the prices of cotton start going up. And so by the time you get to 1820, a couple things have happened. One, the United States is producing more cotton than anyone else in the world. We surpassed India in 1820, became the world's leading producer, and we're supplying 85% of the cotton that the British are taking in at this time. So we are producing almost all the raw cotton that is supplying the massive, gargantuan British textile industry at this time. And it has produced a lot of things, one of which is that this huge migration into places like Alabama and Mississippi. Every third person in Alabama was a slave. Half of everybody in Louisiana, half, every other person was an enslaved person, because that was the labor system that drove the cotton economy and the plantations and everything that's moving on down there. So why am I telling you all of this to talk about Texas, all right? Well, I'm telling you this in part because all of this happens along the very edge of Texas, right up along the border with New Spain. You can see, I don't know if you see those numbers back there. By 1820, there's 153,000 people in Louisiana, 75,000 in Mississippi, 144,000 in Alabama. That's 370,000 people crowded up along the border with New Spain. How many non-Indians are there in Texas? 3,000. So you can see the number disparity, right? You can see the challenge right there. People in Mexico City down here could see this. They were observing all of this happening, and it made them very nervous. Because when you have 370,000 people and almost nobody over here, what's to stop the Americans from coming into Texas and taking the territory for themselves, say all the officials in Mexico City? Why would they not do that? Well, as it turns out, there's no good reason for these folks to come tearing over the border. There's still plenty of land in Mississippi and Alabama, still a lot of great cotton country over there. It's not the population at first that they should be worried about, as it turns out. It's actually the markets that are growing in Mississippi and Alabama and New Orleans. And those are the things that are going to start causing problems, because as it turns out, when all these people move down to this territory and they're building these farms, what do they need to run their farms besides enslaved labor when they can get it? They need horses. And they need a lot of horses. And they need more horses than can be brought down from Virginia or the Carolinas or Tennessee. They need huge numbers of horses. Because while enslaved people were picking the cotton, the horses were doing all of the things like pulling the plows, they were running the cotton gins, they were pulling carts. All the actual brute force of the 19th century is being done by horses or mules or whatever it is you can get. But big horses are being looked for everywhere at this time. And so when you have this massive movement of people down here, there's a giant market for horses. People will pay top dollar for these things in these cotton plantations. They're looking for anyone that can supply that. Who walks in and steps into that breach and is willing to supply horses and get top dollar for their horses? Comanches. Now, we usually don't think of Comanches when you think of Mississippi cotton plantations, right? But it turns out that when this explosion in what becomes the Deep South of the United States happens, the Comanches are one of the biggest earliest beneficiaries of this, because there's a giant demand for horses, and the Comanches have control over the plains of Texas out here by 1820. And they control the horse commerce out there. They controlled some of the largest horse herds out there. They would collect the feral wild horse herds out there. And then they realized very quickly that not very far away, you got to understand, like the Comanches are here, Louisiana's right there. It's not far away whatsoever. And so the Comanches start supplying horses to these cotton plantations in the South. In exchange for that, they start getting weapons. The horses that they're taking over there, they want to exchange for things that they, the Comanches, can't make for themselves. Weapons, knives, other goods that they can't create themselves. And there becomes a massive commerce of the Comanches supplying horses down to these cotton plantations. There's a whole road that gets carved out, known as the Camino Comanche. All right, that's much bigger than the Camino Real, the Royal Highway from San Antonio to Nacogdoches. This one becomes far more developed during this time because it has tens of thousands of horses being run down this direction with huge amounts of money changing hands. Here's why this matters. The Comanches start running out of horses to sell, and they need more. And they round up horses on the prairie, but they figure out very quickly and easily that it's much easier and far more efficient to just go steal the horses from the Spaniards who live in San Antonio, or La Bahia, which will become Goliad, or Nacogdoches, or any of the very small settlements in Texas at the time. And so this wave of violence is unleashed during this time period as the Comanches sweep in and virtually destroy everything in La Bahia, Nacogdoches, and the Spaniards retreat back into San Antonio. The Comanches then start raiding into northern Coahuila, Nuevo León, will become Tamaulipas, a place known as Nuevo Santander. They come raiding in there and are destroying, absolutely destroying northern New Spain during this time period. So much so that the Mexican government is spending 75% of its military budget in this territory just dealing with the Comanches. And after all of that, by the time you get to 1820, all right, within a short five-year period, the Spaniards who live in Texas, who called themselves Tejanos, that's what I'm going to call them for the rest of the talk, Tejanos, which just basically means Texan in Spanish. The Tejanos had retreated into San Antonio, and it basically become Fort San Antonio, and things were so bad because of all this violence associated with horses from the Comanches supplying the cotton plantations that the Tejanos started writing letters to the viceroy in Mexico City saying, "We give up. We're going to have to just abandon this province entirely. It's being destroyed. The bloodshed is too much. We can't last." And that matters for a lot of reasons. But the one I want to emphasize right now is that you have to understand that context if you're going to understand why, when Moses Austin shows up in San Antonio at that particular moment, in December of 1820, that the Spaniards who lived there, the Tejanos who lived there, were willing to listen to whatever he had to say at this particular moment. We usually tell the story of Anglo-Americans coming into Texas starting with Moses Austin, right? And then his son, Stephen F. Austin, who succeeds him when Moses dies soon thereafter. We usually start with the Austins coming in. But what I would argue is that the road to the Austins had been paved already by the Comanches and by the cotton plantations and by all this markets and commerce and the bloodshed that was associated with it. That meant that when the Austins walked into San Antonio and they proposed to bring Americans into Texas, all right. The only reason that didn't sound crazy to the Spaniards who lived there is that they were so desperate at this point for anything that would stop the bloodshed, that would stop the violence. Because what the Austins were proposing was to bring Mississippi to Mexico. What they told the governor, Antonio Martinez in San Antonio, is that, listen, let us come in here. We'll bring in these settlers. They'll start growing cotton. So we have all these Americans who want lands in Texas because the land in Mississippi had gotten so expensive. Free land in Texas would be very appealing. And that would be bringing in the Americans. And for the Spaniards, you'd have non-Indians. You would have non-Comanches. Anyone who's not a Comanche sounds like a really good deal at this point for the Spaniards. And they recognize there's problems associated with this. They recognize this isn't the best possible situation. But given the circumstances with the Comanche raids, they look at Stephen F. Austin and they say, you're the least bad option we have. It's either this or we just abandon the province entirely. All right, and so with that kind of endorsement, they turn loose Stephen F. Austin after his father dies, after Moses Austin dies. They turn loose Stephen F. Austin on bringing in 300 families, which then gets increased several hundred families more as Austin's colony starts growing. And what's really remarkable, because at the moment Austin showed up, Stephen F. Austin showed up in Texas, 1821, is also the moment that Mexico became independent of Spain. All right, and when I teach the Texas History Survey, this gets a little confusing, the chronology for my students. But Mexico becomes independent at that exact same moment. And so Austin and the Tejanos in San Antonio both tell Mexico City, we need to have these Anglo-Americans coming in order to shore up the area and protect it from the Comanches. And what's really interesting about that is that almost all Mexicans agreed, okay, that's not a bad idea. It's not a great idea, maybe. We'd much prefer to have people from the interior of Mexico move to this territory, but since nobody around Mexico City is volunteering to go live next to the Comanches, and the Americans are, we'll invite them in as a least bad option available. That's how bad the violence with the Comanches had gotten. It had gotten to the point that they were willing to invite in the Americans, and that wasn't controversial. But there was something controversial about those Americans when they started coming in, because where are they coming from? Mississippi, Alabama. 90% of Austin's colonists came from the deep south states, Louisiana, Mississippi, and Alabama primarily, 90%. So they're bringing in also with them slaves. And Austin's colony, there was a census done of it in 1825, and when that census was done, it revealed that every fourth person in Austin's colony was a slave. Which makes sense of where they're coming from. This is Mississippi being transplanted into Mexico. The reason that matters, though, is that slavery was a really difficult topic for Mexico when it became independent, because most Mexicans across most of the nation wanted to outlaw slavery at their moment of independence. And there was three main reasons that most all Mexicans could agree that we need to get rid of slavery if it's at all possible. All right? The first reason, almost all Mexicans. If you took a survey of all of Mexico at this time, almost all Mexicans could agree that they needed to outlaw slavery because, one, they had just fought and won a war for liberty and independence. When Father Miguel Hidalgo, who began the revolution in 1810, proclaimed liberty, he also proclaimed the end of enslavement in Mexico. And so most Mexicans thought, it looks bad if you then endorse slavery after fighting for your own liberty. In the United States, our founders had the same sort of internal dialogue and arguments amongst ourselves if slavery should persist and exist after our revolution. Mexico's dealing with that as well. And for most Mexicans, they agreed, let's get rid of it. Why wouldn't we? Especially because of reason number two. Throughout most of Mexico, African slavery, chattel slavery, the way it was practiced in Mississippi, was not a part of the Mexican economy. Now, I want you to get this wrong. Mexico had imported slaves from Africa in huge numbers in the 1500s, and some in the 1600s. But by the 1700s, Mexico had pretty much shifted away towards Indian labor, fulfilling most of its labor needs. And so there's plenty of unfree labor going on in Mexico, mostly with Indians who are virtually enslaved with debt peonage. But there wasn't chattel slavery, African slavery, the way that the Americans had practiced it in almost all of Mexico. So Mexico could get rid of slavery, at least on paper, without really giving up much. There's almost no part of Mexico, except this developing territory in the Northeast, that has slavery a part of it, all right? And there's a third reason, and this is the most powerful one. This is the one most Mexicans brought up, which is when Mexico becomes independent, they need help. They need international help. And what is the biggest, most powerful, and influential country of the 19th century? Great Britain. And what is the country leading the way in anti-slavery legislation by this point in the 1820s? Great Britain. Great Britain had come out as the most ardently anti-slavery nation in the Atlantic world and had been trying to stamp out the slave trade. Mexico needs the help of Great Britain. So if they endorse slavery, they risk alienating the one country they desperately need help from, that they need loans from more than anything else. And so for all those reasons, almost all Mexicans across the country agreed that this was their moment to end slavery, African slavery, and move on. The one exception of that, of course, is up here in Texas, right? Where slavery is actually coming in, and it's actually expanding. And the people who are coming in, like Stephen F. Austin, are saying, listen, Mexico, if you want this to continue, if you still want Anglo colonists to come in here and shore this area up from the Indians, you need to keep slavery. Why? Because of cotton. And Austin minced no words about this. He wrote letters to everybody who would listen to him where he said up and down, left and right, this is how this works. This is how this system is. We're bringing Mississippi to Mexico and slavery is required. The primary product that will elevate us from poverty is cotton. And we cannot do this without the help of slaves. Plain and simple. It's at the base. And Austin said this to everybody. And what's really interesting about that is he had the most sympathetic ear right there in Texas with him, with the Tejanos who lived in San Antonio, who were the political leadership representing Texas to Mexico City. Because the Tejanos didn't like slavery on its own merits, but they did want the development that the cotton economy could bring to them. They wanted settlers there so there'd be a buffer between them and the Comanches because their life had been suffering, the Tejanos had been, up until that moment. But they also wanted the economic development that could come to Texas if cotton came. New Orleans had blown up and had been doing so well. They want that for San Antonio. And so if it's going to take slavery to make that happen, if that's going to be the bridge to a better world for them, then that's a necessary evil to a good end, as far as the Tejanos are concerned. And so the Tejanos join hands with the Anglos in an Anglo-Tejano alliance. And this is something I always emphasize to my students in the Texas class. Nothing that happens in Texas in the 1820s is happening because of one side or the other. It's because they're working together, Anglos and Tejanos uniting in this vision to build a cotton empire in Texas. If the Anglos didn't have the Tejano support, none of it would have occurred. It just couldn't have happened. And they need each other, especially because once Mexico became independent, they start writing a national constitution in Mexico City. They start writing a national charter for what this new country is going to look like. And that's going to decide all kinds of issues. Every aspect of the country is going to be determined there. Whether or not Anglo colonization will be allowed, whether or not slavery will continue to persist, all of those things will be decided at the Constitutional Convention happening in Mexico City, right down over here. And so every state in Mexico sent representatives to Mexico City, including Texas, which sent one of its leading Tejano members from San Antonio, a man named Erasmo Seguin, who goes down to Mexico City and represents Texas in the debates. And they were contentious debates. If you read the constitutional debates, it's amazing how much screaming and yelling happened on the floor of the National Congress because they're building a country and they're trying to decide all these things. And the slavery issue became so tricky. Because every Mexican legislator said, why would we not get rid of slavery if we had the chance? And then Erasmo Seguin, the Tejano, would come down and say, if you do, you give up the North to the Comanches. It will cut this country in half. The Americans will probably invade and will lose at least half of Mexico, if not more. So Keeping slavery legal, at least there, is a necessary evil for the country, and it's important. And he pounded the table and argued. Austin himself went to Mexico City and lobbied personally. And all these things went on and on and on until finally in 1824, the Constitution was finally finished. It was printed. You can imagine how nervous the Anglos and the Tejanos were in San Antonio, waiting to see what had finally been decided. And so back in those days, the way it worked is that the Constitution was printed and then it was put into the mail, which is basically a guy and a horse who was going to ride from Mexico City and then hand off the mail somewhere, kind of like the Pony Express, and it would make its way north all the way up to San Antonio. It took months. And the mail only got to San Antonio once a month. It would go to Saltillo and Coahuila, and then it would come up, and then that one day a month, the rider would show up outside San Antonio and come riding in. And everybody was so excited, they just tackle the guy, take his saddlebags, throw down the mail, and they'd go through it. And when the Constitution arrived, you can imagine, this was a moment of true excitement, but also terror, right? What is our future going to be? So they throw this thing down on the table. There's a whole group of these guys that are around the table as they're going through it, and they're reading through every article in the Constitution of 1824, trying to see what it says about slavery. They get through the whole thing. It doesn't say a single word about slavery. And that's on purpose. Because in the debates within Mexico City, they couldn't come to an agreement. It was too divisive an issue. And so what they decided to do was not mention it at all. And again, that wasn't an oversight. That was because if they don't say anything about it, it becomes a matter for the states to decide. Because this is a federal constitution. It gave certain powers to Mexico City and the national government, and most of the power to the states, which meant slavery would be an issue for states to decide, which meant almost all states in Mexico could just go ahead and outlaw slavery. No big deal. And most of them did, right? The only place that's not going to do that is this crazy wayward region up here. And so you can imagine the Tejanos and the Anglos, when they read this, they go, yay, woo! We get to decide our own issues. This will be good for us. And then some guy probably in the back and throws his hand up and goes, hold on, guys. Wait a second. There's something else in this Constitution we should take a look at. And it turns out that Texas was not going to be its own state within Mexico. All right? It didn't have enough people. This is another result of the Comanches and the destruction of the territory. You needed at least a certain number of people to be a state, and they didn't have enough. So thank you, Comanches. Texas then had to get grafted onto its southern neighbor, Coahuila, to make the very awkwardly named state of Coahuila y Texas. All right? And you can almost hear the in San Antonio as they realize, oh man, that's not good for us. Because that means instead of Texas deciding its issues for itself, instead of San Antonio being the capital of this whole territory, the capital is actually all the way down here in Saltillo, which that was the capital of Coahuila. And Coahuila had way more people. And since legislators were determined by population, when the legislature got together in Saltillo, there were going to be 10 representatives from Coahuila and only one from Texas. Who's going to get outvoted every single time on every single issue, right? It's going to be the Texan. And so you can just, in Texas. The Tejanos send somebody down to Saltillo because they're going to write a constitution, a state constitution. It's going to now decide the same issues. Is slavery going to continue? Is Anglo colonization going to continue? All the same debates happen down there. It's like a replay of Mexico City. All the same tensions. Austin, Stephen F. Austin, sends his brother. It's hard to see this, but this is actually the plaza in Saltillo. This was a picture taken during the U.S.-Mexico War in 1847. And so it's in this building right here off the main plaza that the debates ended up happening over this new state constitution. And so the Tejano sent representatives. Austin sends his brother, a guy named James, who went by the nickname Brown, which I just think that's awesome that James Brown went to Saltillo to argue for the Texans down in Saltillo. And they make all the same arguments, that you can't outlaw slavery or no more migration, then the Comanches take over, you're going to ruin everything. And the Coahuilans say, but we hate slavery. We got to get rid of this thing. And they just butt heads and they argue. Finally, the Tejanos leave, Austin's brother leaves, and they wait to see what happens. And in March 1827, the Constitution of Coahuila and Texas is finished, and it is printed. And the same thing as before. They printed in Saltillo. They put it in the mail, this guy Satchel, on the guy's horse, and he goes off for San Antonio, and he arrives, and they tackle him again. They get out the Constitution, they throw it on the table, and they know this one's going to talk about slavery. They know that for sure. So now the question is, what's it going to say? And they start flipping it, going through it, reading it article by article. Things look good. And then they get to Article 13. And Article 13 was this just knife to the chest moment for the Anglos and Tejanos, because Article 13 said slavery is going to be outlawed in Coahuila and Texas. But the Coahuilans had heard the Texans, and they decided, we're not going to do it all right away. We're going to do it really gradually. So here's how we're going to outlaw slavery. Here's what Article 13 actually said. It said, all the slaves currently in Texas, so anybody who's already been brought in here, you guys will stay slaves for life. Nobody's freed right away. In fact, since you Anglo colonists seem so upset about this slavery issue, the Constitution is going to give you a 6-month window to bring in anyone you want as an enslaved person. Load up, stock up, get as many as you want, bring them in here. All of those people will also be slaves for the rest of their lives. None of them will be freed. The first people to be freed by this Constitution will be the children of those slaves. And so what they said in the Constitution was that basically it's going to take a generation to get there. All right, we'll get to freedom, we'll take a generation. And the Coahuilans thought this is a good compromise issue. It's a good middle ground sort of way to do things, right? We're going to get rid of slavery, but we'll do it gradually. Who could possibly object to this? The Anglos and the Tejanos in Texas. Because the Coahuilans thought, well, this is going to calm everybody down. But it had the opposite effect. And the reason is very straightforward. Because Stephen F. Austin wasn't worried about the slaves currently in Texas. He was worried about colonists continuing to come to Texas. And so if you say in 6 months no more slaves are coming, that means in 6 months nobody is coming from Mississippi or Alabama or Louisiana or any of those states. You've basically cut off Anglo immigration into Texas at that point from the Deep South, because it's all about cotton. And so that's the end of the colonies. If they don't have a continued stream coming in, that's the end of that. And the Tejanos are just as desperately afraid, because the Tejanos realize, oh no, we still haven't outnumbered the Comanches yet. We're only like slightly down the path we need to go. And they both see this as a crisis moment. So much so that they agree, we've got to find a way around this law. This is not just a problem law. This is an immediate emergency. And so Stephen F. Austin convenes an emergency meeting in his colony, in San Felipe de Austin, in his capital. His people come over to his house. They get out on a table and they start yelling and screaming and saying, how? How do we fix this? And they come up with a wonderfully zany scheme. And the plan that they've come up with, and we know this is their plan because they kept minutes on their plan, and they wrote all this stuff down. And their plan is very simple. They decide, here's what we need to do. We need to go ask the Saltillo legislature for a law that will say that any contract you sign in the United States, that contract's legal in Mexico. Sounds really simple. And it has to, because it's got to pass the Saltillo legislature. But it's basically a law that says if you hire someone to build a house in New Orleans, you say, hey, New Orleans carpenter, here's a contract. You're going to build me a house in Texas. When that guy gets to Texas, that contract is still valid. That's what it sounds like, all right? What are they going to use it for? Well, the idea is very simple. We can't have slavery anymore, but we can have contracted labor. So if you're going to bring your slaves to Texas, all you have to do is get to the Louisiana border, free your slaves, and in exchange for their freedom, have them sign 99-year service contracts. At which point, of course, after 99 years, they're free to go, do whatever you want. Once you've done your 99-year service thing, if you're 106, have a wonderful retirement. It's a legal ruse, right? It's a fiction, right? But this shows us, this, I think more than anything, demonstrates how desperate they were to find a way to protect this whole industry and this migration stream. So they come up with this plan, but they can't. The Anglos can't do this by themselves. Who do they need to get this through the legislature? The Tejanos, because they're the ones who represent Texas in Saltillo. And so they send this scheme, and they call it that, down to San Antonio, and the Tejanos get it. This gentleman, in fact, gets it. His name is Jose Antonio Navarro. And Navarro gets this scheme, and he goes, this is a great idea. We should totally do this. Because remember, the Anglos and Tejanos are working together on this whole project. And so Navarro himself goes to Saltillo and takes it to the Saltillo legislature. And I love this because if you go to Saltillo, they have this beautiful little building that has the Congressional Archives. And if you sit down in there, you can read the minutes of the Congress as it went on. And I had the opportunity to do that one summer. And so I was there reading through this, and I got to read what Navarro did when he got in there. And he knows he's sneaking something through, all right? He knows he's doing something under the table. And he waits until there's this big fight over a tax bill in the Saltillo legislature. And everybody's screaming and yelling at each other. And they take a break for lunch. And at that moment, Navarro walks out of the middle of the legislature floor and he goes, "Listen, guys, I know everybody's having their sandwiches right now. It's break time. That's fabulous. All right, just keep eating your sandwiches. I have a quick law. I think it'll take no time to pass. Basically, you guys outlawed slavery, and we are so cool with that. No problem. But there's these people in Ohio who want to come to Texas." He literally says this. "Who want to come to Texas, and they're afraid that contracts in Ohio won't be legal in Texas. Can we just pass this thing? Make sure they're okay with that?" He's just flat out lying to them. And then the legislature goes, "Yeah, sure, that's fine. We can totally do that." And so they pass it as something that becomes known as Decree 56, all right? And Navarro practically runs out of the building going, "I can't believe they bought it." And he writes a letter that says essentially that, but in like flowery 19th century speak. He sends that to Stephen F. Austin saying, "They bought it. They totally did it. You got the law you wanted. Rock it on." And Austin gets that letter like a month later, and he goes, "Fabulous." And it just so happens he has a blank contract just ready to go that he then sends to New Orleans newspapers with a little note appended to it that says, "Here's how you get around Mexican law. Just put your slave names in here, write 99-year service agreement." By the way, these contracts, if you ever read them, they say, "In order to learn the mysteries of agriculture, I'm going to bind myself to you for 99 years. It's amazing, right? And so they do this, right? And then word gets out into the United States, and it works. It works. That's what's also amazing about this. There are all these planters who start coming into Texas using these contracts as this legal loophole to get around the ban on slavery in northern Mexico. And it works, and it continues, and it moves on. And you can imagine, this could only probably work for so long, right? Because at some point, Mexico City, Saltillo, is likely to figure out what's going on, right? Well, that happened faster than probably anyone expected because of a coincidence in New Orleans, which is this. Today, when we sign legal documents, you guys have them notarized, right? Deeds, records of all sorts, you have a notary public, you know, basically attest that it's your signature on there. Well, that was very true in the 19th century. You had to have things notarized. And so these contracts, to be legal, had to be notarized. And everybody who came to Texas would stop in New Orleans along their way. It was one of the biggest cities in the South at the time, and it was a place to get supplies. And so if you're going to get a contract notarized, that's the place to find a notary. So everybody who's coming to Texas with these contracts goes to New Orleans. And the biggest office in New Orleans, Notary Public Office, happened to be across the street from the office of the Consul of Mexico in New Orleans. And so this consul, a guy named Francisco, he would go into his office every day, and there was never a line across the street until after Decree 56 got passed. And then suddenly, every day, he comes into his office, and there's this long line of planters with their slaves across the street getting contracts signed. And this went on for a couple weeks until finally, during a lunch break, he goes across the street and asks the notary, "What's going on?" And the notary says, "Oh, it's great. They passed this loophole law in Mexico. And so you can take slaves in there if you just have a contract. It's all bogus, but you know, you can do that." And the consul goes, "Oh my goodness, what's going on here?" And so the consul starts sending these urgent letters to Mexico City saying the Texans, and what he means by that are the Anglos and the Tejanos, are getting around Mexican law. And all these Americans who are coming in obviously don't care about Mexican law. And there was Mexico City was so alarmed by all of this and several other things that they send a Mexican general up here, a guy named Manuel de Mir y Terán, who does an inspection tour of the colonies, and he says, "Yep, we're losing the whole area up here. This whole place is falling apart." And so Mexico, in 1830, finally decides we have to take drastic measures. And so Mexico in 1830 passes a law that cuts off American immigration into Mexico, which, given current debates, I always think is just so ironic that in 1830, Mexico tries to seal the border from these pesky Americans who keep coming into Mexico and are just ruining things in the Northeast right there. But it's called the Law of April 6, 1830, where they try to seal the border and cut off American immigration and reclaim control of this whole territory that Cotton had basically started ripping away from Mexico. And that might have worked. It really could have. But there was another coincidence that happened, and it happened at just the wrong moment for Mexico in this case, which is in 1830, that same year they tried to seal the border, the price of cotton goes through the roof. And there's a cotton boom from 1830 to 1835, just like the one that happened in 1815 to 1820, where prices double and triple and start going up and up and up and up and up, making cotton lands in Mississippi, but also in Texas, more valuable than they've ever been. And so what happens is something amazing. The Anglo population of Texas doubles in the space of 5 years. By 1830, there were 10,000 Anglos in Texas. By 1835, 5 years later, there are 21,000 Anglos in Texas because of the cotton fields, because of the money that was being made in all these different ways, shapes, and forms. So what you have from 1830 to 1835, essentially, is Mexico City is trying to seal the border and control this territory while more Americans are pouring in than ever before because of the money to be made from cotton. What does that blow up into? The Texas Revolution. There's all these different little fights. There's all these different conflicts. But at its very base, what you have is Mexico City trying to reclaim this territory. Whoopsie. Here we go. Reclaim this territory at the same moment Americans are pouring in faster than ever before. And that blows up into the Texas Revolution. It blows up into this secession of Texas that happens in 1835 and 1836. And in the aftermath of that, Texans create something that had never been in North America before. The Republic of Texas, which is an amazing thing that we never talk about in these terms. But the Republic of Texas, when it is born, is everything the Confederacy will later try to create. The difference is the Confederates don't win their war. The Confederates don't have a chance to create a nation built on cotton the way that they hope. Texans, however, do. And for 9 whole years, they have this Republic of Texas that is as close as we'll ever get to seeing what the Confederacy would have been if it had succeeded and won its war and not lost in 1865. And because Texas, when it becomes independent, declares itself cotton country, and it writes itself a constitution, which you can read online today. It is one of the most boring legal documents you could ever possibly hope to read. It's basically, the Republic of Texas Constitution is basically an awkward copy of the U.S. Constitution. We just sort of skipped over a lot of the flowery language and put the word Republic of Texas instead of the United States in there several times. They were in kind of a hurry. It was written during the Revolution. But there is one thing about the Republic of Texas Constitution that's totally different. And I bet you can guess what that subject is on. Slavery. All right? You read through it and you get to Article 9. Article 9 does something that has never happened in North America before, which is it creates a slaveholder's republic. It says in Article 9 that the Republic of Texas not only has an obligation to defend slavery, it can never, ever, ever outlaw slavery. It can never do anything to attack slavery. It's beyond the bounds of the Congress, the president, or the judiciary to even touch it. In fact, if you are a slaveholder within Texas, you can't free your slaves. It's illegal to do it. Unless you throw those slaves outside the bounds of the Republic of Texas itself. That's how serious it was. And why are they doing this? Well, in part because of what had happened under Mexico. And almost all the fights of the 1820s and early 1830s had been about Anglo migration and the problems of slavery that came with it. But they were also doing it because the Republic of Texas was advertising itself as a haven to Mississippi and Alabama. Because in the 1830s is also the time in the United States when the rise of abolitionism comes, when you have people like William Lloyd Garrison coming out saying slavery's morally wrong and needs to be ended. And northern states in the United States start staking out increasingly strident positions against slavery in the United States and its future. We have people like this man right here, John Quincy Adams. All right, former son of a president himself, had gone back to the House of Representatives after his presidency, the only president we've ever had who went and did that, becoming an anti-slavery voice in the North. And these people are saying all kinds of things about the expansion of slavery and slave power, and the Republic of Texas is advertising itself as a haven for those people. Mississippians, come on over here. You have a slaveholder's republic. This is how we can grow. This is how we can build. That was a strategic decision on the part of the Republic of Texas, but it will help lead to the demise of the Republic of Texas. Because here's the problem that comes with that. When they declared themselves a slaveholder's republic in their constitution, they isolated themselves internationally. This is the problem that Mexico had been worried about, and this is exactly what the Republic of Texas runs into headlong when it becomes independent during this time period. Because as a slaveholder's republic and slave country, there's all kinds of anti-Texas sentiment across the Atlantic world in areas where there's strong anti-slavery sentiment. You have a lot of this in the Northeast. This is an anti-Texas meeting that happened in Boston. But the bigger problem was Great Britain, right? The British came out stridently against slavery, and they refused to recognize the Republic of Texas. Just wouldn't do it. And that's a problem when you're a country. Because if no one recognizes you, then no one's going to lend you money. No one's going to trade with you. No one's going to buy your cotton. You can't do anything unless these countries say you exist. And when Great Britain won't acknowledge you, nobody else will acknowledge you. Only the United States recognized the Republic of Texas. Nobody else would touch them. And who's the biggest buyer of cotton at this time? The British. And so the Republic of Texas finds itself in this horrific situation at the very beginning. Isolated internationally, can't get loans or friends or trade agreements, and its economy starts taking a real tumble. And it starts taking a real public relations beating all the way around. Here's how Texas was being represented in the popular press during this time period. This is a political cartoon. I don't know if you can read the the title of it. It says, Young Texas in Repose. So this figure right here is Texas as a republic. And you can see Texas is, first off, not a nice-looking fella here. But he's posed on the back of an enslaved person right here, right? This is an enslaved person who has been badly beaten by this whip right here, which is a cat of nine tails. He's obviously chained up right here, right? And the point is to have some sympathy with the slave, but the humanity of the slave is not really the point here, or we would see the enslaved person's face. The face that this cartoon wants you to see is Texas. Because what this is, an anti-Texas cartoon warning people about having anything to do with this slaveholding, mongrelized nation that has been created between the United States and Mexico right there. I showed this to my six-year-old daughter earlier today, and she said, that looks like a pig man. But it's not fully human, right? It looks like a werewolf kind of thing. It's got some giant jaws right here, snout. Look at these eyes. It's just terrifying right here. He's got a big scar on his face right here. You probably can't see it, but he actually has a noose around his neck with the Lone Star on it. Good job, guy. He's got tattoos down his arm that say rape, slavery, incest, slavery, fraud, slavery, all his favorite things, just tattooed up and down his arm right there. And it's a warning to anyone who would mess with, have any relations with this place, because it's a mongrelized nation, and he has a Kentucky long rifle, so you have the American influence, but he also has a Mexican sombrero on. Right here. So you have this sort of hybrid intermarriage, interracialized sort of creation in Texas that the whole international community really doesn't know what to do with. And slavery is at the base of all of those things, which means Texas can't get any international friends. And so Texas as a republic at the very beginning has all kinds of problems. But a lot of Texans throw up their hands and say, no, no, it's all going to be okay because we grow cotton and the world needs cotton. And the British might resist for a little while, but they're going to want our cotton. And unfortunately for them, the cotton market at that particular exact moment took an absolute nosedive. 1837, there's a panic. Today we call them recessions and depressions, right? In the 19th century, they were called panics. And there's a panic in 1837 where the whole economy collapses and the cotton markets just go through the floor, right? It's like how oil was at $120 a barrel and went down to $30 a barrel, right? It's rebounded a little bit. Think about that, but even bigger, all right, in the late 1830s. As soon as Texas becomes a republic, the cotton economy collapses. And that's a problem because that's all Texas has. 95% of their export economy was just cotton. The Republic of Texas makes the economy of Detroit look diverse by comparison. Like, that's all they had. So when it went down, Texas went broke. I mean, absolutely broke from the very beginning. And they found themselves in desperate financial straits. So they got to find a way to pay for the government, keep this thing afloat, try to inch along year by year, and they come up with all kinds of desperate measures. One of the first things they do is they just start printing money, which has about as much value as if you printed money in your basement at home. They just start printing money, Republic of Texas money. They believe in cotton so much they actually put it on their money. And this stuff is almost worthless. It trades, a dollar of Texas money trades for 10 cents on the New Orleans streets. It's virtually worthless. And so then the Republic of Texas turns to taxing as much as it possibly can the citizens of the Republic in order to raise money. I always say, if anybody invents a time machine, please never get in that time machine, because the past is a very disgusting place that smells really bad, and you're probably going to catch a disease and not be able to cure yourself, right? So if the DeLorean shows up, don't get in it. But I always tell my students, if you think there was a time in Texas history, and maybe in the Republic, when the government stayed out of your business and didn't tax you very much, you definitely don't want to go to the Republic of Texas. Because the Republic taxed you in every way, shape, and form it possibly could, because they were desperate for revenue. So here's how taxes worked at the time. I don't know how you guys can see this image right here, but this is a tax roll sheet from the Republic of Texas. And in every year, in every county, the county sheriff got one of these lists that had everybody's name on it. So this is Benjamin Gage under G, and then there's the H's and J's and K's. And he would ride around the county on horseback, and he'd come to your house. And he'd say, listen, Benjamin, I need to see all your stuff. And he'd go through all your stuff. And if any of your stuff matched any of these categories up here, you were going to pay taxes on it. So they taxed, I mean, they taxed everything. They taxed wooden clocks. They taxed pocket watches, pleasure carriages. I'm not even really sure what a pleasure carriage is, quite frankly. But like mules, horses, cows, land, slaves especially. That's where people put their money. They taxed everything. So, for example, this guy, you probably can't read it very well, but his name is William Anderson, and this is his tax receipt for the year 1842, and he owed taxes on land in all these different counties right here. He had a slave over 10 years old, was charged 75 cents in tax for that. He had a metal clock, poor guy, 75 cents for that, and a poll tax for a total tax bill of about $24.76. Here's the problem. Nobody had any money to pay their taxes with. You couldn't pay them in chickens. There was no cash. Everybody was broke. And so this had zero effect whatsoever. They couldn't bring in any revenue of any kind. So when we often talk about the Republic of Texas, we like to talk about, and I do in my Texas survey, Sam Houston's presidency, and then Mirabeau Lamar's presidency, and then back again to Sam Houston's presidency. And what's fascinating, and that's all very interesting, but the reality is both of these gentlemen have the exact same pair of handcuffs on them. There's no economy, there's no international agreements, you virtually can do nothing. You can't even pay your government employees. The Republic of Texas careens into itself almost immediately after its birth. And so by the early 1840s, everything's collapsing on itself. I always like to show this picture of the first capital of the Republic of Texas. It didn't look like that at the time, but I think it's a really good visual for the situation Texas found itself in almost immediately, so much so that by the time Sam Houston became president again, all right, in the early 1840s, he looked around himself and he said, this cannot last. This cannot survive. He and his secretary, a guy named Wash Miller, start writing letters that effectively call the Republic a failed state. And they're in a very difficult situation. Mexico invades the Republic twice in 1842. The Republic can't do much about it. Everything's collapsing around them, and they realize they have two options. They can either be reclaimed by Mexico, which was a very real and terrifying possibility, or they could find a way to get annexed to the United States. And that annexation, it's an entire story unto itself we don't have time for. But that is the goal that Sam Houston sets for his second term as president, is to get the Republic to save this region by having it annexed to the United States. That finally, after many shenanigans, succeeds in 1845. Texas joins the United States, all right, as the westernmost outpost of the American South at that point. And that is what leads to this gigantic war between the United States and Mexico from 1846 to 1848 that brings in all of this, and frankly, all of this right here, into the United States, the reason we reached the Pacific Ocean, the reason the American Southwest is what it is today, is because of this story. And all these developments in this place that we live that redefines the border and, frankly, citizenship in this country in a way that, again, we're talking about today, that is in the presidential debates for this year, is a part of our national discussion about who we are as a people. All of those things can be traced back to the place we're in today and these stories that come back to, again, cotton, slavery, migration, and all of these things and how they happen to be compressed into this amazing 50-year period that didn't just redefine Texas, but really redefined North America. Thank you guys very much. I appreciate you guys listening to me.
Any questions, comments, or protests?
This is a library. Say what you want.
I'm so glad I can walk out. such a hard time standing behind a podium. Can I move this?
Oh, questions? Great. Surely there's one. So, it's like the auction house. Do you have a question? No? You have a question?
Thank you. I will tell my mother that. Thank you. I appreciate that.
What? Oh, you have a question. Okay.
We'll go here and we'll go here.
Okay, the Cherokee War in 1839. Was there anything related to the cotton story that had something to do with that?
Okay, great question. So what she's referring to is when Mirabeau Lamar became president in the late 1830s, Houston had this peace policy with the Indians because he knew it was cheaper than war. He was also, obviously, you know, very involved with the Cherokees himself. But Lamar comes in, Mirabeau Lamar, when he's inaugurated, he says, listen, we need to have a cotton empire that reaches to the Pacific Ocean, and the first thing we got to do is get rid of all these Indians in East Texas. And so he did in East Texas what had been done in his native Georgia, which is declare war on the Indians. He actually says, Lamar does in his inauguration speech, basically, we're just going to kill them all. And so he resurrects the Texas army, which Houston had disbanded essentially, and then declares war. It's not just the Cherokees, but it's all those tribes in eastern Texas, the Delawares, Shawnees, a lot of groups that had actually moved into Texas to escape what had been going on in the American South. And they were decimated and then run back into the United States as a result of that. So that's part of kind of clearing the space for Anglo settlement, which included cotton, but frankly just included Texas asserting itself as a nation state.
Well, I was curious about Stephen F. Austin, how old he was when he brought the families down into Mexico or Texas. And then what did he do next? Because Sam Houston ends up kind of taking over and being leader of the Republic.
That's a really interesting story. So, Stephen F. Austin is an amazing character. And if you are all interested in him, the best biography is one written by a man named Greg Cantrell. It's called Stephen F. Austin, Impresario of Texas. And it's a beautifully written book. But the short version on Austin is he comes in his 20s, and late 20s, and he is kind of makes this his life's work, right? He comes in for the same reason his dad had planned to come in, which is to rescue the family finances. I would say make a quick buck, but they were looking to make some money and then possibly move on. But he realizes this is going to be a lifetime thing, and he kind of throws himself into all of that. And he really pledges allegiance to Mexico. I mean, a lot of the early settlers thought of themselves as Anglo-Mexicans and really bought into being a part of Mexico. But Austin, like a lot of his colonists, became increasingly disillusioned by the late 1820s and the early 1830s, mostly because they felt that Mexico City really wasn't listening to what they were saying, that they needed to control the region. That included slavery, that included other things, but they wanted the autonomy to be able to decide those things for themselves. And so Austin went to Mexico City in 1833 to try to get permission for Texas to become an independent state. He was denied that by Santa Anna, then thrown into jail for protesting, essentially. And he comes back to Texas ardently saying, no, we need to rebel. But the story of Stephen F. Austin gets really sad after that because he goes to the United States during the Texas Revolution to raise money for the Texas Revolution, and he's moderately successful at that. And he comes back after the Revolution, and when it's clear there's going to be a republic, he puts his name in to be the first president. He runs against Sam Houston. Houston gets about 5,000 votes. Stephen F. Austin only gets 500 votes. Actually, Austin came in third in that election. There was another candidate who got even more votes than Austin. And that really demonstrates, I think, how much migration had come into Texas during the early 1830s. And all those people didn't care what Austin had done in the 1820s. They knew about Sam Houston and the Battle of San Jacinto and all that had gone on with that. And Houston then named Stephen F. Austin as his Secretary of State. So it was actually Austin who was the very first Secretary of State of the Republic of Texas, and he's the one who forges a plan to get the British to recognize Texas by using cotton as their leverage. But Austin never gets to see what happens because he dies of pneumonia in December of 1836 in the town of Columbia, basically in the back of a ramshackle cabin. It's a really sad ending to what you know some historians have called the father of Texas, but by that we mean the leading land agent bringing in Anglo colonists.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Brought our two youngest Great presentation, by the way.
Thank you.
So the question was, so, you know, it sounded like Austin and Houston, great influence, you know, lots of progress, but turmoil, you know, with the formation of the Republic and then the collapse of it. What's going on in the minds of the Tejanos then, you know, during this time?
That's a great question. And that's sort of like the organizing theme of my book, because so much of this stuff has been written from the Anglo perspective exclusively. And so I start the book in San Antonio with the Tejano perspective on the world as it's shaping around them, and I end the book with that as well. And so during the 1820s, the Tejanos feel very strongly that this is their ticket, cotton is. This cotton economy is their ticket. And so they are hand in glove with the Anglos. Once the revolution happens, though, things shift dramatically, in part because the Tejanos no longer have the political power they did. Once it's no longer part of Mexico, the Tejanos are now a very small population in the Republic and therefore have very little political influence in the Republic. And so you have a few people like a guy named Juan Seguin, who was Erasmo Seguin, if you guys remember him from earlier, his son. You have a few of them, Navarro, who are in the Texas legislature, but their voices are increasingly pushed out. And what happens during the Republic is that the migration that comes in, and there is a steady migration that comes in from the United States, absolutely none of those settlers give a whit about what the Tejanos had done before the Texas Revolution. And so you have this pushing and marginalizing of the Tejanos. And the best example of that is the story of Juan Seguin. So I'm going to give you a very quick little thumbnail sketch. I told you about Erasmo Seguin, right? He's the guy who goes to Mexico City and represents Texas in the Constitutional Convention of 1824. He is the only reason Anglo colonization is allowed to persist, because he defends it and makes sure that slavery is not outlawed. His son, Juan Seguin, fights during the Texas Revolution with the Anglos. He is at the Alamo. He's one of the couriers out. That's why he survives the Alamo. He is then at San Jacinto. He's one of 19 Tejanos on cavalrymen at the Battle of San Jacinto. He is, by every definition, a Texas patriot and hero and all those things you want to call it. He's also one of the very first senators in the Texas legislature. He's in the Republic of Texas legislature, right? That's not enough in the Republic of Texas. By 1842, he is run out of Texas for being a Tejano and for being a Mexican and for being a part of the Anglos suspect him of encouraging a Mexican army to come in and take over San Antonio. And so Juan Seguin is literally run out by a lynch mob out of Texas and has to go to Mexico to escape the lynch mob. You know what happens to him when he gets to Mexico? He's arrested by the Mexicans for leading the Texas Revolution and thrown in jail. He can't win. He is then taken out of jail, and he ends up fighting with Santa Anna during the U.S.-Mexico War on the side of Mexico against some of his former compatriots in the U.S. Army at the Battle of Buena Vista. And so there's this really sad story, is that the Tejanos, in desperation, try this idea that spins out of their control, and ultimately they become some of the biggest victims of that circumstance, because they get marginalized and pushed out. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you. Okay.
I'll come over there.
I'm from the Southeast, and the plantations in the Southeast are the history of the Southeast, but I've never heard about plantations in the Southwest.
Yeah.
Where were they, and what were the slaves, where did the slaves live in the housing compared to the Southeast?
That's a great question. So in Texas, we talk about the Southwest. Okay, so basically Austin's colony concentrated around the Brazos and Colorado rivers right here. All right, and so the majority of plantation agriculture in the 19th century existed up through about the Colorado River, somewhat west of that, but you kind of think 100th Meridian kind of stuff, all right, where the rainfall changes dramatically. All of this is, you know, basically the same as the Mississippi River Valley, right? You have that same sort of deep agriculture. So it wasn't much different for the colonists who came out here to grow cotton in East Texas. And the way that the plantations were actually set up, I'm dialing back to a picture of a Texas plantation, was very similar. Here we go. to what you would have seen in Mississippi or Alabama, right? And so we're not talking about, I was in Virginia for a very long time, and you have these very, like, you know, beautiful plantation homes that obviously people put a lot of money into. This is like Fast and Furious, right? So right here, this is the big house, which you can see is not very big, right? And so they would cut down, you know, trees and whatever to build their house, and all these little are the slave cabins that are scattered out around the area. Sometimes they were surrounding like this in a horseshoe shape around the big house. Often there was, depending on how large the plantation was, there might be, I won't say a village, but a concentration of them a little bit away from the main house and things like that. I mean, most people who own slaves did not own 20. Most people who own slaves, actually, most people didn't own slaves. Most white Southerners did not own slaves. It was just too expensive. But if you did, you probably had one or two. And so most likely they would have a cabin not far from yours. If you were wealthy enough to own a lot, it'd be spread out in this sort of way. But this is kind of what it looked like. And this is how they cleared the fields, actually. See these stumps? It's really interesting. If you're in the Texas frontier and you want to clear land for cotton farming, you wouldn't go chop down every tree because that'd take forever. What you would do is what was called cinching or girdling. You would strip off the bark in a circle around the base of the tree, and the bark is actually like the veins, the circulatory system of a tree. And without that, the tree rots and then will fall over. And so it's a quick way to clear a lot of fields that way. And so when you had Mexican officials come to the Texas plantations, they would write these diary entries talking about these like cemeteries of stumps that were out in the cotton fields out there, which struck the Mexican officials as a very strange sort of vision. But it's the same thing you would have seen in Mississippi. This is actually a small picture of a much bigger sketch. And over in this area right here, they had a cotton gin and a cotton press as well, which they actually carted in from Mississippi overland in order to get it into Texas and to be able to use it.
I'm a native Texan. I took a history course, Texas history course in grade school. I took a Texas history course in high school. I took a Texas history course at Texas A&M. I have never heard anything you've said tonight with respect to prior to 1842 or 3. Is your book unusual or?
Yes. I mean, yes it is. I will say, okay, so let me tell you a little story. I grew up in Houston. And I took 4th and 7th grade Texas history. And I also never heard any of that, about cotton or slavery or any of that sort of stuff. I heard about the Alamo. I heard about the Republic, right? Every place I've ever lived, I think, picks its moment in history as its identifying moment. Like for Virginia, it's the colonial era, Thomas Jefferson, George Washington, or the Civil War, because it was the capital of the Confederacy. For Texas, it's always been the Republic, right? And the Republic kind of is this different moment. We were our own country, and it's this moment of pride in a certain regard. It's taught that way. I always thought that was interesting. I thought it was really fascinating. But I was interested in Texas history. I went to Texas A&M. I took a Texas history course at Texas A&M. Got a B in it, actually. That didn't go very well for me. But I didn't hear any of this stuff there. I was more interested in the class that another professor was teaching on the American South. I thought that was fascinating. And so I went to study Mississippi and Alabama. I went to the University of Virginia to study slavery. And then I was following, in my research, I was following these slaveholders who were going to Mississippi and Alabama to grow cotton. And I was watching them, I was observing them, and then some of them went into Texas. And I thought that was really weird, because I'd never heard of that. I knew about Stephen F. Austin, but I never thought about it being an extension of the South, and so I started following that, and then I started going to Mexico and doing research in Mexico City and in Saltillo and in Nuevo León, and came to see there's just so much of this stuff, and I don't have a good answer as to why it hasn't been written up. The records are there. The records are actually overwhelmingly there. The slavery and cotton has never been a part of how we tell these stories, but it's at the absolute very base of all of these stories. And I think what makes it interesting is that it ties Texas into this much broader world that doesn't just include Texas, but includes North America and really the larger Atlantic world. Because if you don't have the British buying cotton, if you don't have these controversies over slavery, if you don't have the Mexican government trying to position itself, none of this happens the way that it ends up happening. So it is new, and for that reason, it's been kind of startling, I think, for some people who haven't had that story before, this being at the center of it.
Our youngest guest.
Oh, please.
So when you said they paid the Indians with weapons, mm-hmm. why wouldn't they choose something like money or resources?
Oh, very good question. Very good question. So the question is, why did the Comanches trade horses for guns? Is that what you're asking? As opposed to maybe money? They can pay in cash? That's great. The reason is because for the Comanches, the guns were valuable. They could actually use them. They could hunt buffalo. But what they could really do is that they would have an advantage over the Apaches or the Wichitas or any of the other Indians that lived out in that area. They could have a big, powerful advantage if they had much bigger, more powerful guns. If they took money from the Americans, they had nowhere to spend that because there was no stores around them. There was no place for them to buy stuff. It was much more valuable for them to get these guns, especially because they couldn't make the guns themselves. But they could use them in order to get an advantage over their enemies or whoever they wanted to. And so they became the most powerful military force, really, in Texas by trading all of those horses for rifles and pistols and knives and things like that. Very good question.
What kind of weapons did they use?
Well, it depended on the situation. Anything could be a weapon depending on the circumstances, but they preferred long rifles because for a long time, guns had been basically, you put a little ball, all right, in a cannon, essentially, or your shotgun has this like long barrel and it's really smooth. And so it's kind of like throwing a shot put. You just kind of go, boom, all right? But somebody had invented this thing called a rifled barrel, which had this like groove in it that went in a circle. So when you fired a long rifle, it would take the bullet and it would spin it like a football. You throw a football, you can throw it much farther and much more accurately. And so that became the weapon that if you could afford it and they were expensive, you would buy a nice long rifle because you could shoot very far, very accurately, and that made you a very strong, strong military force. They'd also buy pistols. And then everybody just loved to have these bowie knives, which were basically just giant knives. They looked like a giant spear, basically. But if you got in a time machine and went back to that period, everybody was armed to the teeth if they were out on the frontier. They had a giant knife on one hip, a pistol over here, and were probably carrying a long rifle of some sort.
Any other questions, comments? Okay. While I'm walking to her, I was going to say that the Mustang Creek here in Allen is, when the pioneers got here, they noticed Mustang horses. So they named it Mustang Creek. And those were, I guess, a few of the horses that escaped the Comanches trade to the...
Well, you know, it's funny, when the colonists were coming into Texas, they were often riding on horses that the Comanches had stolen from Texas. And so the horses were actually coming home. It's like, oh, I know this place. I was here like 6 months ago. They were just riding back in on horses that had been taken away originally.
I have two questions. One, I assume that Texas came in as a slave state.
Yes, that was a part of the negotiations during annexation. There was many different points that were negotiated, but one was that Texas would come in as a state, and that meant they could write their own state constitution, and so they could define that they came in as a slave state. And that was like a non-negotiable for the Republic, and it went through just fine from that perspective for the negotiators. So that was definitely part of that.
And how did they get the Comanches out? And I would assume other...
Yeah.
Various Indians that were roaming around.
So the story of the Indians in Texas is really interesting. The short version is when the colonists start coming in, they don't move into the plains, so they don't move into where the Comanches live. So the Tejanos had hoped there'd be this big buffer that never really is created. What they do move to are where the Karankawas, if you've ever heard of them, they live down by the coast around near Galveston, Houston, places like that. And Stephen F. Austin's colonists declare war on the Karankawas and basically run them out. Then they push out the Indians north of them, the Tonkawas and the Wacos. They push them further north from there and kind of push them out. When the Republic's created, Mirabeau Lamar then declares war on all the Indians in Texas and clears East Texas out of them. The Comanches remain on the plains, and they will remain in charge really until the 1850s when there's a huge immigration that starts coming in. And what happens to the Comanches ultimately is that they get outnumbered. They were never more than about 15 to 20,000. By the time you get to the post-Civil War era, they're dwindled down to about 12,000. But by that point, the population of Texas is 800,000. And so the Comanches just simply get outrun and outnumbered. And when the U.S. Army moves in the Reconstruction period and starts building forts moving west, there become the basically what's the last of the Indian Wars. And by 1875, it's June 1875, the last of the Comanches under the command of Quanah Parker, and it's actually a conglomeration of all kinds of Plains Indians that surrenders. That ends Indian power in Texas, and it's mostly just a simple fact that they were outnumbered. But it's remarkable. 1875, 1821 is when the Comanches controlled everything. By 1875, a little more than 50 years later, they've been run out. And it's just a sheer reflection of just how much immigration from the United States had come into Texas by that point.
Were there other people immigrating to Texas besides the plantation people?
That's a great question. Who's coming in? If you read the records, Stephen F. Austin kept this wonderful diary of where people were coming from. If you got to his colony, you had to go to his office in San Felipe de Austin, and he would say, "Where are you from?" And you would say, "I'm from Georgia, I'm from New York, I'm from Alabama," wherever you're from, and he wrote it down. If you add all those up, which I have, you find out that 90% of his colonists came from the Deep South and the American South. Almost all of them, so they're coming from Mississippi, not Maine. They're coming from Alabama, not Illinois. That's because of the cotton culture. That doesn't change in the 1850s. There's actually more people from native to Germany who are living in Texas in the 1850s than are from the northern United States. You do the census in 1850, there's about 10,000 people who are native to the northern United States. There's 20,000 people from the Germanic states who had moved into Texas by that point. Everybody else, almost to a T, are Southerners in some form or fashion or another. And so that trend continues because, again, it's cotton commerce that's defining Texas' economy. In the 1850s, Texas becomes the leading producer of cotton in the United States. And that is a title that we have held on to ever since. We are still, it's us in California usually, who vie for the title of the most, of the biggest producer of cotton in the country.
The man who negotiated the annexation of the Republic of Texas into the United States, the town of Allen is named for Ebenezer Allen. He was the last Secretary of State for the Republic of Texas. Any other questions, comments, or protest? I have one final question. We were always taught in textbooks when I was in school, that religion was a cause of the Texas Revolution. And from your presentation tonight, it sounds like money and cotton and slavery was more factors than religion was.
Yeah, religion was a factor in the early 1820s and then sort of disappeared very quickly. Because when Mexico became independent, it was a Catholic country. And so the deal that Moses Austin had struck and that Stephen F. Austin inherited said, all your settlers have to be Catholic, and they have to attest to being Catholic when they show up. And Austin was worried about that at the beginning because that was going to be, for the Protestant settlers of the United States, that was going to be a very big deal. But then it became very quickly a wink and a nod kind of situation. It's like you'd show up and go, "Are you Catholic? Right? Right?" And you'd sign here, and then Father Muldoon will show up eventually, but he never did. And that was basically that. And so for the first 3 or 4 years, Austin would write letters, and he said there are two things slowing down immigration. One is religion, and one is slavery. And he said very quickly, "I know we're getting nowhere on the religion thing, so we'll just leave that where it is. But we can do something about the slavery issue." And as word got out that it wasn't being enforced, it sort of dissipated. By the time you get to the early 1830s, it's really not in there.
Any other final questions, comments, protests? Dr. Torgett, thank you so much.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate you guys coming out.